All right, I am here today to discuss the DKAN Open Data Platform, which is a Drupal distribution. DKAN is a Drupal-based, community-driven, free and open-source open data platform offering a full suite of cataloging, publishing, and data visualization features. So DKAN, as a platform, gives organizations and individuals the power to publish and open up their data to the public. There are a large number of sites throughout the internet built on DKAN, including HealthData.gov for the Department of Health and Human Services. Their site was previously built on CKAN, which was DKAN's predecessor. And HealthData.gov previously was almost like a library that had been built far too small for the amount of books and articles and papers stored within it. And when their old CKAN site was bursting, it seems the Department of Health and Human Services approached the Project DKAN team to build the brand new healthdata.gov in 2015, which currently hosts nearly 4,000 different data sets. And these data sets have been federated from sources like the CDC, the NIH, the National Cancer Institute, the State of New York, State of California. All of these different agencies, all of their data gets pulled onto healthdata.gov and hosted there for anyone who'd like to see it. Another great site that's built on DKAN is the State of California's Open Data Portal. And I can show you these in the tabs that I've got up here. So there's healthdata.gov, and there's the State of California's Open Data Portal. And the State of California project is also pretty great. I refer to them as the other orange-producing state. But they approached the Project DKAN team, and they wanted us to put together a portal that would have all of their environmental data about droughts and floods and everything that California deals with, all of their transit data, all of their health data, all of this information about California, all in one place for the citizens. So again, DKAN was used for this, and it's a pretty great Drupal-based platform for doing so. So those are just two examples of sites built on DKAN. Ultimately, DKAN sites have been used to open up data across 30 different countries, 35 cities, and 5 U.S. states and federal agencies. And these are the sites we know about. Because it is an open source, open data platform, literally anyone can spin up a DKAN site of their own. And if you're using something like Pantheon, which helps you do it in one click, it only takes a couple of minutes to spin up an out-of-the-box DKAN portal where you can start editing the front page and adding data sets and resources yourself. I'll get into that in a little bit, but you know, when you do spin up a brand new DKAN site out of the box, it's generally going to look like this, and you'll have an about page, a place for data sets, topics, transportation, education, everything all in one place. So DKAN, what the Project DKAN team ultimately does is we're in the business of building libraries, and it's up to you to put the books in it to open it up to your community. And as I was saying, those sites, the ones I have listed here, those are just the ones we know about. So what's really cool is that out there in the Drupal ecosystem, we've discovered DKAN sites that have purposes, like there's one in Italy that's against mafia money laundering and corruption. And they're using all this data and they're hosting it all in one place to bring down the freaking mafia. How cool is that? And so if I ever go disappearing, that is what happened. So there's also there's DKAN sites. Germany is using it for a lot of public transit data. There was also EbolaData.org in 2015 that hosted information for the countries of Sierra Leone and Liberia about the spread of Ebola and all of the treatments and treatment centers that were located throughout the countries. I mean, it's just really amazing because if you build it, they will come. Just make sure to let people know that you built your site so that they actually do come. So DKAN was identified by the U.S. federal government's Project Open Data, which came to be under the Obama administration, as a ready-to-use tool that will help agencies jumpstart their open data efforts, and it is a real implementable solution to significantly reduce the barrier to implementing open data at your agency. What does all of this mean? It means that a lot of government agencies used to just throw up a bunch of Excel spreadsheets on their sites and go, have fun with this. Not much metadata, not much in the way of information beyond that, just here's some Excel 2004 files that are badly formatted. Have fun with that. So yeah, DKAN, not only is it something that can be used to host all of your open data in one place and publish it, but also through being able to create visualizations and being able to preview the data before downloading it. All of these things make it so much more accessible than just have some Excel spreadsheets. Not that Excel spreadsheets are bad, but, you know, it's nice to have them tidy and well-formatted. So before I get back into DKAN, I know that I am coming from years within the open data community, and there's a lot of folks from within the Drupal community who don't really know what I'm talking about when I say open data. And there's a lot of things that go into making data open. And of course, the difference between information and data is that information is just pure knowledge that can be transferred, but data is structured information that is available in a very specific way. So data, when it is open to the public, should be published in a convenient, modifiable form that could be linked elsewhere and easily shared. It should be provided in a standard structured format so that it is machine readable across multiple platforms. Data should be guaranteed to be available and consistent over time. For example, it wouldn't make any sense if the US Census decided to do 1980, 1990, 2010, where did 2000 go? It should also be guaranteed to be available and consistent over time. So, you know, if you're releasing yearly reports of the flu in the US, have it formatted the same way so that if someone wants to be able to make a chart or a data story from it, they don't have to sort through five different files of the same data that have all been formatted differently. And finally, open data should be traceable back to where it originates because this is a college classroom and we all know the importance of citing our sources. And a few more things about what makes open data open. Open data is data that is free to access, use, and share. Open data can be easily redistributed. And open data should be open to the general public. I may sound redundant in many places here, but all of this really good to know. The general public must be able to freely use, reuse, and redistribute the data. So if it is data you have to pay for to access, where there's some kind of barrier or firewall, or you can only use a $200 software platform in order to open it, and it can't be opened but with anything open source, that's not really tidy data. That's not really something that's machine readable across platforms. You want to avoid the whole proprietary thing and just make it so that anyone can open what you're looking at, whether it's in Google Docs, OpenOffice, ArcGIS, R, you know, multiple platforms depending on the file format. So let's go back to DKAN itself. Who is DKAN for? Well, that would be the publishers, such as city, state, or local government agencies, HealthData.gov, State of California, State of North Dakota, that would like to share their information about education, the environment, healthcare, and more. Also nonprofits, NGOs, and universities, like the nonprofit I mentioned in Italy during the anti-mafia efforts. And finally, DKAN's also for the users, citizens, researchers, students, and journalists who want to access the data and make good use of it. I know from having been in academia myself when I was finishing my master's in geography and GIS, this was several years ago, and open data portals were very different than they are today, and finding data was really awful, and I would be spending these late nights until 3 a.m. in the GIS lab looking for like these exact data sets, and a lot of cities and states and agencies that I was doing these reports on, they didn't even have open data portals at the time, and I would have to go to some local university's FTP site to download like the shapefile for their state, and it would just be such a long, arduous process. That, like, honestly, from the user side, like, I've been working on this project for 3 years. Yes, it's a passion project, but, like, going back to my academia self way before that, I think about these open data portals, and I think about all the students and journalists using them now, and I'm like, yes, thank you for making it easier for them. No 3 a.m. nights in the geography lab. So when data is uploaded to DKAN, and I will jump back to the DKAN site and show you this in action, it is organized in three different categories. There are groups, and those are a content type that represent data publishers or agencies, and these groups contain data sets. So a group would be Department of Health, Department of Transportation, Parks and Rec. That would be a group, which is one and the same as a publisher. Groups contain data sets, and those categorize the data and label it with the appropriate metadata. So in this sense, groups would be the drawers of a big file cabinet, and data sets would be the manila folders. And a lot of people confuse data sets and resources because you hear data set and you think, well, that's the data, right? No, that is the resource. A data set is the container for the data, it's the folder. The data resources are all of the actual files that go inside of that. So a spreadsheet, a map, or in real life, a CD-ROM, a thumb drive, anything you could actually put within a folder, those are resources within a data set. Oh, and also data sets have metadata associated with them, much like in real life. If I had an envelope containing things and I was writing the who, what, when, where, why about what's contained within on the outside of it, that way if someone finds the folder, they know what the heck is going on inside of it. That is metadata. That is associated with data sets about all of the resources within. Oh, and what's cool about DKAN is that resources can also be remotely linked files or imported APIs. So here's the hierarchy. I promise I will jump back to the site and show you this in action, but it just explains group, Department of City Planning, contains data sets, demographics, and zoning maps, and each of these data sets contain resources within them, whether it's a CSV file, a PDF, an ArcGIS shapefile, or an XLSX file. Many of these file formats can also be previewed within DKAN, which, going back to my 3 a.m. geography lab self, makes me very happy because you do not have to go out of your way to spend the time and the energy and the hard drive space to download individual files just to open them up and then find out that that's not what you're looking for. The previews within DKAN make life much easier. So yeah, just showing the groups, data sets, resources, hierarchy. I think I'll use the State of California site as an example. So when you visit and you see the front page, welcome, here's a bunch of different topics, here's all of our different agencies within the state, like Department of Fish and Wildlife and Department of Water Resources, I say, okay, well, cool, I would like to see these data sets. So I'm going to go up here to the navigation bar, and this is pretty much one and the same on all sites built on DKAN, whether it's HealthData.gov or State of California or anything else. You click right on data sets, and that will take you to the list of data sets. Now, this is a relatively new site, so there are only 45 data sets hosted on it so far. If I jump back over here to healthdata.gov, one of my favorite examples, so far, 3,699 data sets. And when you're browsing through, you can use the left-hand sidebar to narrow it down by topics, tags, format, etc. And also, when you're looking at previews of data sets, you can see that they contain different resource types within. So this one right over here from the state of Missouri about veteran health providers has a CSV, an RDF, a JSON, and an XML file all within it. So I don't even have to open the data set to know what's inside of it and if it's the thing I'm looking for. Now, many of the sites will also have longer descriptions for their resources, but because healthdata.gov pulls in data sets from so many different agencies, sometimes they get imported without many descriptions, but you still have all the resources listed within the data set. There's a description, there's also, you can see it's from the state of Missouri originally, and there's also the Open Data Commons license associated with it. And if you wanted to use the metadata from the data set elsewhere, there's a DKAN API that allows you to access it as a JSON or RDF automatically. This is all built in. And here's the metadata about this data set. So we see the publisher, State of Missouri. We can see when it was last modified, when it was released, and contact name and contact email in case you need to reach out to someone about it. So yeah, that's how things are organized within DKAN. And I touched on this before when I was talking about metadata. Again, it's the who, what, when, where, why of data. Super helpful. Again, we're all used to metadata in real life. If you find a photo in your mom's house of a man and woman in front of a restaurant, you're like, I have no information about this. There's nothing going on here. And your mom tells you, no, that's Uncle Bob and Aunt June, and they're in front of Sonny's restaurant in 1962. Boom, that's the metadata. So yes, DKAN is built to comply with a wide number of national and international metadata standards, including DCAT and Project Open Data, which you can read more about I do not remember the exact link directly, also because the Trump administration has changed the URLs for many Obama administration efforts. But if you Google Project Open Data, or it should still work at projectopendata.cio.gov, you can read more about data standardization and open data standards between U.S. government agencies. So, data previews. I also touched on these before. I love these very much. So you can preview resources within DKAN in three different formats, as a grid, as a graph, or as a map. So when I'm looking through these data sets, I can actually pull up an example on here. You have the ability to just check it out directly as either a grid, or if there are lat-long coordinates contained within the resource, it will be viewable as a map. and will automatically load those lat-long locations. And when you click on them, you'll be able to find all of the information associated with them.
Parses that and upload?
Pardon me?
Is it parse that and upload? When the resource is uploaded, is it parsed?
Yes, it is. It can be imported to the DKAN data store, which parses it and stores, especially if it's a CSV, because CSV is the most common file type. It will take these enormous CSVs and parse them down and store them in the data store so that they can be accessed most efficiently through the DKAN API.
Do they use a custom entity type? Are they nodes? What are those?
These are all nodes that are content types within DKAN. Groups, data sets, and resources are all content types for data organization. And when you add a new resource, like it is a piece of content on the site, pages are also a content type, pretty cut and dry. Visualizations are a custom content type that I'll get into. And there's also harvest sources as a content type. If you're harvesting data from an outside site, such as USDA.gov, and you want to take some of that agricultural data, you can put in USDA.gov/data.json as a harvest source and be able to pull specific data sets by filtering for keywords and categories that you want.
So are each one of those rows an individual node, or are they stored in aggregate somewhere?
They're stored in aggregate as tables.
Okay.
But what's really cool is, and I wish I had this example in here. Let me see if I can pull up my own. Yes, on my own DKAN site, I should be able to show you an example of data previews. This is my own little, it's not on here because it refreshed. I have a DKAN site hosted on Jenkins for demonstration purposes. But yeah, if you do go on demo.dkan.com, you can explore data sets and resources hosted on there and be able to check out the grid graph and map previews. And it's pretty handy because once you have a graph or a map preview of that resource, if it is something that's graphable or mappable, you can then embed the preview elsewhere.
Sure. I think maybe if you upload a CSV file as a data set, Drupal's actually putting that into the database, the table, or it's just storing the file.
So I don't know all the details about how the sausage gets made,
sure,
but
right.
You are putting in beef and getting sausage. Now, in between, I mean, luckily there's nothing else mean from it. But the DKAN data store, when you import very large files into the DKAN data store, that's when they're parsed and stored effectively in the back end to be efficiently accessed. Yes?
Do you have to know if it's using Solr or some other index caching system?
Search is built on Solr.
Okay, that probably might be where it's storing it. Also,
you'd have to customize it so much that it feels.
Yeah, but I don't believe the output is through Solr.
Yeah,
it's not
to preview a data set because you have to customize the fields and.
Takes a file, creates a table based on the source of data.
I was curious, what kind of numbers are you seeing as far as data, like this thing can handle performantly? A million rows, 10 million rows, 100 million rows?
So right now, our developer team, because DKAN recently got transferred from its old provider and maintainer, a company called GovDelivery/Granicus, to Civic Actions. Steve also works with me at Civic Actions. Right now, we are trying to revamp DKAN and make it bigger and better, so I don't have an exact answer for you yet on the number of rows. But all I know is that it can handle absolutely massive CSVs that have broken other open data platforms made by companies that I won't name, definitely not any companies called Socrata. But the city of New York, where I live, despite being from Broward County originally, 954 Ride or Die, the city of New York, their open data platform is hosted, it hosts these massive, massive CSV files, like all of the traffic violations in New York State, and people cannot drive there, so there are a lot. And it's able to handle those CSVs that break Socrata's sites and manage to work perfectly fine on ours, so I'm just going to say that Drupal rules. So, grid graph and map previews, super easy to do within DKAN. Because of time constraints, I'm not going to show you exactly how to do those when previewing a data resource, but I highly recommend trying them out because they're fun to play with. And again, if it's CSV with lat-long points or GeoJSON coordinates, automatically spits it out as a map. You can preview it, you can click on all the points and find the information associated in those rows. Very, very helpful. Visualizations are also a content type in DKAN. These are using the D3 JavaScript library. you can create from files hosted within DKAN or external files that you're using remotely. All sorts of really beautiful charts. We got bar charts, we got line charts, we got pie charts, we got charts. So they can all be created very easily without code. If you want to add some custom CSS, you can, but these are all super easy to create as a content type within DKAN. And then once the visualization is created, you can actually host the visualization, well, embed the visualization within a within either a page on the front page itself, such as on this site, Open Data Louisville, Kentucky. You've got a really beautiful map right here. And you can also embed external visualizations that have been created using platforms such as Tableau, charts and maps, ArcGIS maps, and previews of shapefiles. If anyone's coming from the GIS world, that's my background. Being able to preview shapefiles, really important. That is built into out-of-the-box DKAN. And you can also embed maps from CardoDB. Very helpful platform. So it's nice to be able to have these interactive animated charts and maps to really open up your data, because there's so much rich data out there, but if it's locked into spreadsheets and lines of numbers and text that no one wants to read, it's just not going to make the same impact as being able to visualize and like fully explain it to your audience. So another content type within DKAN that really helps open it up and explain things, these are DKAN data stories. Data stories, again, it's a specific content type.
I was going to ask, did you say what charting library it's using?
D3.
Okay.
Yes. But data stories are a content type where basically it's almost like putting together a newspaper page layout and having all of the different boxes where you want to put things. You can choose the exact layout and put everything where you want it to go. So whether it's images or visualizations or text content, everything can be hosted in one location, similar to a blog. So if you have a city open data portal where they're building, they're putting up new bike lanes throughout the city, and they want to be able to update citizens with maps of where these new bike lanes are and charts of how many more people are using bikes in the city, they would be able to do that with data stories. And they could even put sequential ones like the March, April, and May updates to keep the citizens posted. So they could be used pretty much any way that you would like to.
Like a drag and drop Monopoly situation, or?
Yes, everything is drag and drop through the in-place editor. So again, you can create really rich, robust data stories without a single line of code. And this is something that I teach to government bureaucrats that have been working for these agencies for like 30 some odd years, and they're like, previous experience with data is just dusty file cabinets. And if I can teach them to use the in-place editor to create visualizations and data stories and open up everything, then I assure you it is open to all. Sorry to tease about old bureaucrats. I hope no one rats on me to their local congressman. There are also DKAN data dashboards. These are a content type in DKAN, and these are really cool too. I love data dashboards. You're probably familiar with data dashboards in your everyday life from going to weather.com or accuweather.com. And what's really cool about those dashboards is whenever you type your zip code in, it doesn't matter what your zip code is, time of year, what's going on, the charts and maps and all the content is updated to whatever is happening in that moment, but the dashboard ultimately looks the same and everything's in the same place no matter what time of year it is. So that's something we provide with data dashboards. They're basically the cousins of data stories. They're super, super similar. But they provide a one-stop shop for visualizing all of your data on one place. So I will jump over here to the DKAN demo site to just show an example real quick of a data dashboard that I created. This one is using FBI data about crime in the top 10 most populous cities in the country. So there's text content explaining it. There's also the visualizations I created within DKAN. And what's neat about this, like this property crime one, for example, is that I can click in and out of the bubbles for the different axes and be able to narrow down exactly which indices I want to look at. So, for example, I just want to see motor vehicle theft, nothing else. Let's get rid of all of these other crimes. And boom, that's just motor vehicle theft. And now we see that Dallas has a big problem with that. When you put it down to burglary, oh boy, Phoenix and Dallas. Dallas, gotta work on that.
You gotta just have some place to steal the stuff. With the stuff, with the car, you take the car.
That's true.
It makes sense. Perfectly sensible.
And I can also stack these indices as well. So I can see that my city, New York, actually isn't that bad as Houston and San Antonio. No, I'm just teasing lovingly. I'm a geography person. I love every city. But also lots of text content and pie charts that I was able to create within DKAN, and lots of handy-dandy bullet points for understanding all of this data. So this is just one example of what you can do with data dashboards. Really, again, it's a very robust content type, and yeah, one-stop shop for everything you want to see about your data.
Did y'all build mobile responsiveness into the charts?
Pardon me?
Did y'all build mobile responsiveness into the charting?
That's an awesome question.
V3 doesn't support it out of the box. It has to be done customly.
I am pretty positive that mobile responsiveness is built in out of the box, because I do QA, so I've previewed a lot of these sites on my phone, regular iPhone 8. I have not tested the interactive visualizations on my phone, so I can't tell you if those work. I do not fully expect them to, because it's mobile. However, like, the visualizations are responsive if you're loading them onto a page on your phone. Yes. So there's other content types in DKAN: pages, visualizations, I mentioned those, data stories, data dashboards. In fact, this is a slide that didn't need to be here, because that happens sometimes. And you've got a visualization up on your phone. It's working. That is definitely a chart.
It's not perfect, but it's pretty
yes.
good.
Yes.
Woohoo! Got some overlap on stuff.
Woo.
Yay, live QA.
So if you are publishing your data with DKAN, there's so much more that's built into it. So the metadata compliance and customization tools I mentioned, there are tags, topics, and taxonomies for browsing and organizing through your data, browsing through and organizing your data. Roles and permissions for moderating user workflows, which if you're running an agency like the Department of Health and Human Services or the State of California, there are untold numbers of employees working for them, and you need to have a way where if there is an intern who was just hired and they just need to digitize some data sets, but you really don't want them to be able to delete or edit or modify anyone else's data, we have roles, permissions, and workflows built in so that that will not happen, and the supervisors can maintain everything and make sure the site is not overrun by Russian trolls. Oh, and also data harvesting. I had mentioned the DKAN Data Harvester module. It is built into out-of-the-box 114, which is the latest distribution, and be able to harvest from outside sources, such as USDA.gov or any other open data portal that has a data.json endpoint available. And APIs to allow your data to be used elsewhere, such as a mobile app. What does this mean? Well, if HealthData.gov were to have listings of all of the flu shot locations in the country with lat long points where you can figure out exactly where they are, and someone decided to build a mobile app and said, hey, you know, I want to let people know where they can get these flu shots. I'm going to build an app called Flu Shot Finder using this API from healthdata.gov, live streaming all of that data and pulling it into the app. Boom, I've got my Flu Shot Finder app. I was able to build it using this open data without having to pay for it, without having to jump through any specific hoops. And boom, just as a regular citizen who was interested in doing this, I was able to create Flu Shot Finder, and then the flu went away and everyone was happy forever. There's also the DKAN Data Uploader. When you're putting in new resources, you can upload it from your hard drive or from a remote source. Chart and map previews, I had mentioned, great to be able to preview those resources. DKAN Data Store for efficiently parsing and storing large data sets. There's also the integrated CMS, because Drupal rules, for adding blogs, videos, slideshows, and more. You can upload all of these file types and even put these within your data stories, data dashboards, and so on. And there's also multilingual translation available. One of our projects that we've been working on for the state of Georgia, for their schools, it's really awesome. There's a lot of custom React use with it. But if you are a parent in the state of Georgia and you want to look up the information on your local schools in the area, it spits out automatic custom React dashboards that show, like, this public school has a B+ in English and a C in math, and the demographics are there are this many kids who require accessibility, and it's awesome to be able to see that if you're looking for that specific school. And I mentioned this because of multilingual translation. All of these custom React dashboards and how they're able to put out custom PDFs, all of that available in Spanish with one click because Drupal rules. And I think we're also working on a project for the city of Medellin, Colombia, where we're also translating DKAN into Colombian Spanish. So it's only getting bigger and better with more translations over time.
Yeah, Is it being put back in the I18N effort?
Pardon me?
Is that being contributed back to the I18N effort?
Oh, I don't know, but that's an excellent question.
I think it is.
I hope so.
We're doing with DKAN, so, you know, it still fits in the Drupal ecosystem.
Yes.
It's all contributed back in.
And we've also got French and Arabic translations of DKAN coming out through our partners in Tunisia, Angry Cactus, where a development firm that has helped us tremendously. So I did mention roles and permissions. Just go back to this real quick. Site manager, editor, content creator, these roles help you manage things in your agency. Again, do not let the intern that you just hired be able to edit and modify things that would cause massive security implications. The supervisors can stay on top of things. The editors, sort of the middle role, they can be able to moderate site content but not have the same sort of security power as a site manager. And content creator, again, that's that intern role. That's the newbie who you just want to give them. You want to give them a couple of keys but not the full set of keys. So the workbench module is a way to... It's basically the supersized version of the built-in roles and permissions. So if you're an agency that's absolutely massive and you need even more custom workflows to be able to move things through drafts, needs review, and publish before it goes live on the site, you want to install the workbench module and then have even more of those hoops to jump through before things can go live on the site. And those are good hoops. Those are moderation hoops. DKAN and Drupal, they're a single code base. CKAN, the Comprehensive Knowledge Access Network, that was not built on Drupal. That was DKAN's predecessor from many years ago, and it would often be combined with Drupal or WordPress or another hosting platform, and then it would just turn into a double code base pain to maintain and update. What's awesome about DKAN and Drupal, they come together as one package, one code base to update and maintain. Super easy for anyone with an inexpensive hosting kit environment to create an open data catalog of their own. And if you don't have your own hosting environment, there's Acquia, Pantheon, and so on. And it can be enabled in existing DKAN, in existing Drupal sites, so that anyone who's already using Drupal can then just add all of the DKAN modules on and easily start to publish open data. And finally, DKAN offers an easy option for everyone who's already adopted PHP or Drupal, because while Drupal, you know, it's not absolutely massive when it comes to the traditional everyday internet, when it comes to these government agency sites and the government open data community, Drupal powers like the vast, vast majority of them. I should have actual numbers for those stats next time, but hey, you know.
It's astonishing. It's astonishing.
Yeah. It's pretty amazing, and I'm so grateful to be part of the Drupal community and to know that Drupal is being used for things that matter this much and have so much of an impact on the world. So I mentioned that hosting can be done by yourself or on-premise of your company, agency, etc., or through a third party such as Acquia or Pantheon. A very brief slide, but here's one that is not so brief about the framework upon which DKAN is built. This is basically how it all gets put together, and I won't read through everything on here, but you can see that a lot of the features in DKAN are built on the Drupal core, where you've got the content management and general Drupal framework, and the user management, all of these very powerful capabilities of Drupal, and also contributed modules from the DKAN Drupal community. For example, the Federal Extras package, that is a custom module for DKAN, that we've been using with the Department of Health and Human Services and the Department of Veterans Affairs and many other agencies because it helps them comply with many, many more federal regulations. There's also ways to clone nodes. There's Solar Search that I had mentioned. And these are just contributed things. Then DKAN itself has so much that already comes with it out of the box. The harvesting, being able to build the catalog from scratch. The content types I'd mentioned about dashboards and data stories, the open data schema mapper to change your custom metadata schema, and also theming. And man, there is just so much that goes into DKAN, but really if you're familiar with Drupal already, you'll find it very easy to start using DKAN on top of it. right now, Project DKAN, we have put together a list of our core values because this really is a community effort from the ground up. It is open source. It is open data. Like, everything comes down to these specific core values. So we pulled members of the DKAN community who have been using it, and it took about a month or so to put together this list of core values for the project. So community and user empowerment, transparency and openness, collaboration and creativity, inclusiveness and accessibility, 508 compliance, accessibility is very important and those tools are built in. Sustainability and extensibility. The more modules, the better. The more custom work that we're able to do to make really cool things happen, like those school data dashboards, the better. We just want to make DKAN the ultimate open data tool and just open things up. The roadmap is also open and it's posted online at getdkan.org. We will be updating it quarterly with 2 development items per quarter, and also frequently with security updates, bug fixes, and other enhancements. All of this is online at getdkan.org/roadmap. DKAN is maintained by my company, Civic Actions. I just started working for them despite having worked on DKAN for about 3 years now, so I have followed DKAN around as it's evolved. I'm one of the old school users. And yeah, we keep Project DKAN open and fully sustainable.
Did you say whether it was on D7 or D8?
It's on D7. I promise you that one day it will be on D8. I cannot tell you when that day will be, but it will come and it will be an excellent day.
Okay. So that is why you can warn it anywhere.
Support for DKAN is provided by Civic Actions, again, the maintainer. Angry Cactus, who I mentioned, in Tunisia, run by a guy from New Zealand, so I cannot even begin to express how much of an open, global effort this is. The National Democratic Institute, and ANI. And DKAN's freely available under the GPL version 2 open source license. And very, very last slide. I will leave you all with this. If you want to learn more about DKAN, you can read more at getdkan.org. If you have specific questions or ones that I might not be able to answer because I am not a backend developer, info@getdkan.org. There's also the DKAN Slack network where you can ask questions, get support. That's available at dkan.slack.com. You can tweet us at getdkan. We also have release notes and everything else posted on GitHub at github.com/getdkan. And finally, a Facebook page that is maintained sometimes by me. I will answer you on there. Not too much going on with the open data community on Facebook, but always good to have a little storefront over there just in case.
There's a shock.
So, that's true, because Facebook and openness don't really go. No.
That's why the RNC is not moving yet.
Exactly. We just keep a DKAN page over there to be like, come on over to our Slack network. So, yeah, that is DKAN. Does anyone have any questions?
Can you do matchups between different data sets and different, the maintainer, different resources?
Oh, you mean to be able to perform sets? Like joins and relationships between data sets?
And then create that as an independent data source?
With custom React, yes, you are able to do that, but out of the box, DKAN right now it cannot currently join and do other such relationships between data sets.
So if you have 50 states donating or giving their data set, you have a matchup between all 50 states, you have independent state reports, as an example for the states.
Yeah, it would be independent state reports, although they could be combined together. The new versions of DKAN that are coming out now that it's going to be maintained by Civic Actions will have more capability regarding being able to join data sets and query multiple data sets at once, although you can use SQL queries. And other built-in table queries to query tables right now from a single data set.
Cool.
Yes?
So D8's on its way. Is there actually a repo started and any collaboration going on? Can I jump on?
I mean, I could just run out of the classroom and hide under a table right now.
But you can start one.
We're getting there, damn it. We're getting there. Drupal 8 will happen. It's just because DKAN went through so much upheaval last year with being transferred from its old maintainer to its new maintainer. The Drupal 8 upgrade. It will happen. I just don't have any exact dates or information yet. I'm sorry about that.
It's a big lift because, I mean, you saw the list of custom modules.
Yeah.
It's a big lift, so.
Yes. And we're ready for the lifting. It's just right now is like the pre-lifting montage where we're like running up the stairs and working out and, you know, getting it together for Drupal 8.
Are the .gov contributes even done yet for 8? Or did they kill those last year?
Good question.
Yeah, that's a fantastic question.
More questions? Anyone?
I'm worried down the road.
I don't know if this is slightly off topic, but as somebody who's active and enthusiastic about open data and about Drupal, I go to some open data hackathons in the Twin Cities, and I'm usually the only Drupal person there, and sort of have a hard time getting anybody to work on a Drupal project. And I'm just wondering about advice or, I don't know, thoughts on where Drupal fits into the overall open data scheme. Is that unusual in the Twin Cities? If you know that there's so few Drupal people involved.
You know, you said the Twin Cities in Minnesota, right? That's why I went. Because DKAN's old maintainers, GovDelivery, were based in St. Paul.
Yeah,
and there is a large Drupal community in St. Paul, and I feel like there's so many people, because I think I've seen you commenting on the Slack network. I feel like we've got people in the Twin Cities to hook you up with. And like.
Well, no, I'm very active in both the open data and the Drupal community.
Awesome.
But they don't cross over.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
yeah.
I'm the only one from the local Drupal community. And now I know there are Drupal folks probably that work for GovDelivery, but they're not involved in the Drupal community.
Yeah, and they're not involved in open data anymore. It really is difficult joining the Drupal and open data communities together because they are so different.
Since
you're
not recording now, I'm curious about, since we use GovDelivery, so I'm curious if you could just shed a little light on why you can't move, what happened there?
They're my former employer, and I signed lots of paperwork about that. So that's my answer.
She went with the project.
Right.
So that she is DKAN.
No, I'm one of the modules.
It's like the advanced help.
Yeah. That was a great
yes. They put in very enthusiastic GIS lady as part of the module package.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, I cannot comment on that subject. I'm sorry. But it basically GovDelivery lost interest in open data. That's really like Trump won the election.
Open.
They're like, oh, well, the whole internet's going to close now. This sucks. Okay, we're getting rid of open data. So they shut down their open data efforts. And it's a shame because honestly, like when you're working with so many government agencies and government clients, keeping things open and transparent in this day and age is a radical act.
Mm.
Especially when the Trump administration is shutting down like the LGBTQ portal that Obama had for queer-identified Americans and all sorts of information. There was information for folks immigrating to the U.S. that has since been deleted. When you have a government that is openly hostile to openness and transparency, then being able to facilitate it and keep these sites running, it's such a huge act to be a part of.
It's your target, too, if you're one of the contractors who are on that. You become a target for the government.
No, definitely. Yeah, I'm sure they're all over my Facebook. Nah, looking at my cat videos.
He's going to be working on a contract with the government.
Oh yeah, and like as a government contractor, it's very stressful. The past couple times the government has shut down, like, whew. Like, listen, we're just here to try to build your libraries and open up your stuff. Like, please just let us keep opening things up so that governments and politicians don't hide all of this data away, and then we're not finding out anything about like who dumped toxic waste where, or like which politicians are getting bonuses that they might not have earned and may actually be illegal. I mean, there's open data. A lot of the stuff I mentioned, because you know, in my job life, I'm going to talk about environmental data and health data and such. But in my like personal life, I'm the one who's like, yeah, open it up, like get it all out there to the people. Like we gotta see this, and it's the only way we're gonna fight man. So, yeah. And you can have both. Yeah, always good to have both. But, yes, that's off the record, everything I just said. Totally off the record.
Well, I'm sorry, I missed it.
No! But, yeah, Civic Actions, like, it's really beautiful now, the relationship between DKAN and Civic Actions. Like, Civic Actions is such a great home for this project. There's so many just enthusiastic compassionate, like conscientious people who are on the team, and a lot of like old school Drupal folks. Adam Bergstein was like the number one person when it came to making sure that DKAN, the project, would stay alive and would still be such an active part of the Drupal community as a whole. And I cannot thank him enough. He's not even in this room, and I'm thanking him.
And if you're passionate about open data, we're hiring.
Oh, are we?
We're
all right. Look at that.
The D8 migration promise we have.
Yeah.
So it sounds like you're going to need some D8 people.
Yes, we're definitely going to need some D8 people. They should have like online D8ing where you're looking for your ideal Drupal 8 match. Yeah, I'm here to answer any other questions. Don't be afraid to ask anything that I might have mentioned before. There are honestly no stupid questions. There are only awesome questions, because all of these questions show an interest in open data, and open data is the only way that we are going to make America use Drupal again. I don't know. I was going somewhere with that, and then just lost it.
And you saw a red hat, and you freaked out.
Yeah, exactly. Although, if you do use Red Hat, you can still use DKAN.
The Red Hat.
Linux joke.
Yeah.
What if they consider changing the
name? Oh.
I think they probably did, but pretty much their brand, they should just sue.
Yeah, Red Hat came out before all those Red Hats.
They did.
Red Hat should sue the Red Hats.
Yeah. Because that's going to go over well.
Yes, and anything I said that did sound politically biased anyway. It was all joking. It was all humor.
Is your personal opinion and not the opinion of?
Not the opinion of anyone who isn't me. So, yeah, I'll leave it at that. But yeah, getdkan.org, info@getdkan.org, join the DKAN Slack network, get involved. We will be happy to see you there. Woo!